do certain limited things. And the Constitution is a grant of limited authority. Article 1, Section 8, which is Congress's powers, lists out the powers that Congress has. It enumerates them. It's not plenary or full powers. It says, here's the list. This is what you can do. This is what you can't do. And it never says that Congress has this full power to make you buy something, and if not, it will fine you for it. So I stood up against Obamacare, and I spoke passionately about it as much as I could. And we fought the good fight. And I believe that the U.S. Senate made a difference. I believe that we were there to help turn this tide that led to the election of a Republican House and led to the election of Marco Rubio and Alan West in November of last year. And here's why. We spent 23 straight days in a row in December of 2009 arguing against Obamacare. We made them have the fullest and longest debate that the rules would allow. Now, sometimes we had to come in the morning at 1 in the morning to vote, 7 a.m. in the morning to vote. But we showed the American people what this bill was all about. 23 consecutive days, the longest continuous session of the United States Senate since the U.S. Senate decided whether or not to go to war in World War I. And what happened after that? People in this country figured out that this was a problem. They figured out that the hope and change that was being sold was not the hope and change they wanted. And what do? We elected a U.S. Senator, a Republican, from Massachusetts in January shortly thereafter. Gives me hope for Broward County. Anything is possible. But that started to turn the tide. But the Democrats weren't done. They wanted, you know, the Dodd-Frank bill, another onerous piece of regulation not supported by the Constitution, creating tremendous powers in these folks who were able to take a company and liquidate it, basically kill it in a legal sense, without a judge ever being able to evaluate it. Amazing power for unelected people in government. And the list goes on and on and on. And when I was there, my friends, I stood up against all of these things. And I was recognized for it. I got a 93% rating from the American Conservative Union. I got the Taxpayer Hero Award, the Tax Fighter Award, 100% from the Chamber of Commerce, 100% from the Christian Coalition, 100% from the Family Research Council, and all of the groups that evaluate our values. Because I believe in limited government. And I believe that we have a moral breakdown in this country that our government is starting. At the basis of our financial challenges, I'm going to talk about that in a minute, there is a moral crisis. And the moral crisis is that these big government liberals in Washington, people like Barack Obama and Bill Nelson, they believe that you and your family and your church and your community can't take care of yourself. They believe that Washington knows best. That we, the little people, can't figure it out on our own. So they create a government that's bigger and more expensive and more intrusive. It requires more of your tax dollars. And slowly, every day, we're losing a piece of our liberty. We are going to lose the entrepreneurial spirit. Because when the businessman or woman thinks, you know, there's just too many taxes, there's just too much red tape, too much regulation, I'm not going to start that new business. I'm not going to hire that next worker. Then we lose what it means to be Americans. And that's where we are today. And what's outgrown from that moral crisis and that fundamental misunderstanding of where our government is this financial crisis. And my friends, the most alarming thing to me that was quickly apparent to me was the way this government misspends your money. It is out of control. And it is far worse than you know. It's far worse than I knew. I always knew Washington spent too much money. I always knew there was too much bureaucracy. I always knew that we had a problem with our budget, but I never knew how bad it was until I saw it right up close and firsthand. Let me give you some examples of that. When I first got there, one of the first things I had to vote on was an appropriations bill, a spending bill. And this bill was 15%, I believe it was, more than the one they passed the last time. It was for roads. You know, not a bad thing. We're all for roads, right? But my thinking from having a business perspective, helping run one of the 200 largest privately held businesses in Florida, every day in my business, I'm looking at accounts receivable, I'm looking at expenses, I'm trying to figure out how we're creating new revenue, I'm looking how we can cut costs. That's what business people do. That's what you do with your businesses, it's what you do with your families. So when they say they're going to raise it 15%, I'm thinking, well, what are we cutting 15%? And when I would ask the old timers that, they'd look at me like, oh, you're the new kid. You don't get it. I didn't get it because it doesn't make any sense. You may have heard that this Congress has failed to pass a budget for 800 days. Longest period in modern times. We don't have a budget. They're just passing continuing spending resolutions. You should know this. They never have a budget. Not the way you and I think about a budget. Because a budget in our minds is, let's look at what we're going to take in to determine what we're going to spend. They just look at what they spent last year. They don't even look at revenues. So here's where we are. Our country is $14.5 trillion in debt. That's just on the balance sheet debt, and I'll talk about that for a minute. We spend $200 billion a year in interest payments alone. These numbers, trillions, billions, they're hard to put your brain around, so allow me this moment to explain this because it helps me understand it. What's $1 billion? Anybody know? It's 1,000 million. What's $1 trillion? It's 1,000 billion. Or 1,000,000,000. If we put $1 bills on the floor like this tile is here and laid them side to side, edge to edge, $1 million would cover 2 football fields. $1 billion would cover Key West, Florida. 3.4 square miles of $1 bills. If you've been to Key West, Florida, think of Duval Street with $1 bills running down. Stranger things have happened in Key West. $1 trillion covers Rhode Island twice. Put it this way. If you were to spend $1 million a day from the birth of Jesus Christ until today, you would not spend $1 trillion. $1 million a day from the birth of Jesus Christ until 2011, you would not yet have spent $1 trillion. This, my friends, is an enormous amount of money. And your government is going in debt each year now, $1.5 trillion. $3 trillion in the last two, $5 trillion in the last four. Our national debt's $14.6 trillion. It is on its way to $26 trillion by the end of this decade. It is snowballing now. It is cascading. It is to the tipping point where it is out of control. Why does this matter to you? Why does it matter to those two young girls right here? Why does it matter to your kids and grandkids? Because we are to the point where it is unsustainable. We are to the day of reckoning. The interest payment's $200 billion. Put that in perspective, our state budget is $70 billion. Almost three times our state budget in interest payments alone, a lot of it being paid to places like China that holds our debt. Next year, the interest payment's $260. By 2020, the interest payment is $900. Your government can't make a $900 billion interest payment. Sometime between now and 2020, if we don't curb spending dramatically, what you're seeing happening in Greece, in Portugal, in Ireland, in Spain is going to happen here, but there's not going to be anybody to bail us out. This debt ceiling debate is a manufactured crisis. It's being done by Republicans who are trying to shine a light on the real crisis. The real crisis is the debt, not the ceiling. So for Democrats, it's like the tip of the iceberg. They see the tip of the iceberg, here's the ship of state, they say, okay, let's shave the top off, and we'll sail over it. But you know, what lies beneath the water is what's really dangerous. If we don't curb our spending dramatically in the next 3 to 5 years, we are going to lose what it means to be Americans. And these two young girls, and your kids, and my kids, and your grandkids, are going to grow up in a diminished America. They're going to grow up in America where you can't achieve your hopes and dreams. They're going to grow up in America where hard work is not going to be enough. And I don't want to live in that America. And that's why I'm running for the U.S. Senate. Frankly, for me and my family, with 4 little kids, 8 and under, and a really good job, and people still calling me senator, it would be smart for me not to do this, personally. But I feel a calling because I know how bad it is. And I don't want to look my four kids in the eyes when they get older and have them say to me, Daddy, you knew how bad it was. Why didn't you try to fix it? I believe in to whom much is given, much is expected. So that's why I'm trying to go back. And that's why I need your help. We need to send people to Washington who have the courage of their convictions, who will be principled, who will solve problems, and then when they're done doing that, come home. It's not supposed to be a 30-year job. Our founding fathers never intended for people to go to the U.S. Senate and grow old and go out to pasture. Our founding fathers intended you to do your work and then, like Washington, go back home and return to your plow. And that's what I would do. If I have the chance to go back, I won't stay forever. I'd like to stay long enough to make sure America's on the right path. And then I'll come back home to Florida, spend time with my family. But we've got to send the right people. Not people who are just trying to climb the political ladder, who are going from state house to state senate to the next thing on the ladder, but people who are there to do what's right. I've spent most of my life in the private sector. I have spent some time in public service, and I'm proud of it. But I'm doing this because we've got to have people who've got a business background and people who are not so in love with the job that all they want to do is stay in it, which is most of the people in the U.S. Senate.